Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Welcome to our monthly event, Voices of the Salton Sea. We are very happy to have you here. Tonight is a fun night. We wanted to do one a little bit lighter right after the elections. We're going to do something to appreciate our natural environment, see many different views and perspectives of the Salton Sea, and really appreciate this place, as well as each other and the people that have helped grow this campaign over the years. So tonight is the Salton Seascape photo tour and art show, as you know. We're bringing together the views, art, and sights of the Salton Sea, micro to macro, sunrise and sunset, in the waves or by a feather. The Salton Sea is uniquely beautiful. So the EcoMedia Compass, who we are, I'll tell you a little bit more about us. We're a 501c3 nonprofit founded in 2011. My name is Kerry Morrison. I'm the executive director, and we have a great board of directors and many different volunteers that we work with for environmental restoration, awareness, education, and ultimately the betterment of the Salton Sea and the stewardship of this region. Our roots are deep in art, and this came from the understanding that art can tell a story, can tell a deep story and give people a connection and the belief that a place is valuable and beautiful and worth taking care of. So I'm gonna turn it over to the thing that started the EcoMedia Compass. So this is the very first thing that started EcoMedia Compass, was a music video for a song that I wrote, and we came with a very diverse crew out to tell a story of a place through art and music. And there's some deep lines about betterment with each other and the environment in here, but I'll let you take the rest for yourself. But after many years, we've done a lot to bring the science to the art, to tell the story of science and solutions, the political views and the politicians to the art, to tell the story of restoration and how we can do these things. So I'm gonna start with a music video, and then we have a great schedule for tonight. We have some fantastic prizes. We have an auction. We have our keynote speaker, Kevin Key, who will be joining us and presenting in a little bit. And we're going to visit a few places around the sea that we really think you're going to enjoy. So without further ado, we'll turn it over to the first project that started the EcoMedia Compass and told us that we knew we needed to be here and we knew we needed to help. This is in 2011.
Come back around and see what you're missing. It's more than love, it's more than life. It's all I've tried, it's all you'll find. Come back around, they call it karma. The way you let me down, don't fall through, just close your eyes, it's all you do. Keep it even tone.
Okay, so this was many moons ago.
And that was cool.
Thanks, Kevin. Many moons ago, and this taught us some lessons throughout the story that had some lessons built in as well. And so there was a character that was leading the way wearing green, and it was a vision that we needed to be directed by a green way of living our lives on this planet to create and maintain a balance in nature and in life. There was a character that represented greed, a character that represented war, a character that represented the balance of species, and they were frozen. And then they came back to and realized that they would be able to bring these things to balance. And you may see that we had a compass leading the way. And this music video and this project that started in art led the way for the Save Our Sea campaign and this nonprofit that has been going on 9.5 years. So we'll have our 10-year anniversary next year, next spring. So we're excited to see that art is continuing to pave a way for awareness, education, and now restoration for Salton Sea. One place that has been particularly inspired by art and that draws a lot of different kinds of artists is the area over in Salvation Mountain, Slab City, and East Jesus. And so I'm going to jump over to a piece by PBS that covers this area. If you haven't been, it's a fascinating place. And I want to show you a little bit more about some of the art communities that do exist around the Salton Sea. So we're going to jump over to East Jesus.
But some believe this emptiness can be filled.
Oh, this piece here, it has an interesting history.
Do we see this? there we go.
Hear Brian Sadler tell it, the open-air desert museum of East Jesus is a living, breathing experiment in free expression. Just off the shore of the Salton Sea, it's a commune that allows painters, sculptors, and conceptual artists to do battle with the sand, the sun, and the wind.
This is El Brino, the lost dinosaur of the Salton Sea. Touch any part of it because it's like powder.
Oh yeah.
It goes back to powder. It
disintegrates.
Yeah, totally disintegrates.
Is that part of what's going on, disintegration? The idea that things are temporary and this environment?
That is the message I'm getting, that nothing on this level, on this plane, it's really worth clinging to. Because it's just stuff. It's all just stuff.
The brainchild of late artist Charles Russell, East Jesus began on the dump site of Slab City, a squatter's camp on an abandoned military base just outside of Neyland, California, and the location of Leonard Knight's famed Salvation Mountain.
As soon as Charlie Russell heard about his adventure out here in the desert using trash to build a temple to God. He said he wanted to be a part of that because he was always yearning to make something out of nothing.
In the years that followed, Russell invited more and more artists to East Jesus to come and build, create, and watch what happens to the work as the desert takes hold.
This one here.
I have to demonstrate it to you.
Okay.
Because it's really not about the tin cans in there. It's all about this.
Sound.
Making sound out of just pebbles and empty cans.
Oh, it's great.
It can sound like the rain.
After Russell passed away in 2011, the growing roster of artists in East Jesus formed the tax-exempt Chisterius Foundation to protect the project.
His friends rallied around and said, look, we don't want this idea to die. We've all had such a great time contributing and inspiring one another. And so they formed a 501(c) to preserve his memory.
In 2013, the foundation purchased the 30 acres of land that surround the collection. And 3 years later, East Jesus became an accredited member of the California Museum Association.
Moving right along, this is our TV wall. One of the most photographed and shared pieces, I think, of East Jesus online, because people love it. It says so many different things to so many different people.
But this isn't the only artist haven along the Salton Sea.
So if you have not been over to the Slab City, Salvation Mountain, East Jesus area, we highly recommend it. It is unlike any place you will have ever seen, and probably ever will be. But there are some other communities around the Salton Sea, and we have a lot of fantastic artists that keep telling the story of the Salton Sea and why we need to save it. One of the artists that we have worked with for many years and whose work we really appreciate and whose spirit and knowledge about the Salton Sea we also really appreciate. So I'm going to turn it over to our keynote, Kevin Key, local Salton Sea photographer. And after that, we are going to dive into the work of two more artists. And we look forward to seeing this continue in awareness for the Salton Sea. And Kevin?
Okay. So let's see here. Let's share my video.
Thank you so much for joining us tonight, Kevin.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for inviting me. So let's see here. Let me get this started here. Let's see. Oh, yeah, I just wanted to give a quick intro. So, yeah, I've been fascinated with the Salton Sea since also about 9 years, around 2011. Well, actually, I've been fascinated with a few years before that, but I finally made my first trip out to the Salton Sea in 2011. I don't know if I mentioned this during the last presentation a couple months ago, but what really sparked my interest in the Salton Sea, and actually, off to say before this, I didn't even know there was such a thing as the Salton Sea, was there was a photo exhibit at the Museum of Photographic Arts. I forgot who the author of the exhibit was, but that really inspired me when I saw some photos of the Salton Sea, both like then and now photos of it during its heyday and then during the various stages of decay. But ever since then, I can't get enough of the Salton Sea. And as most of you know, I go out there quite frequently. So the first few parts of this video are just slides. So this is, let me see if I can take the, if I click on it there, that takes the, so that'll look good on everyone's screen?
It looks fantastic here.
Cool, thanks. Okay, so this was taken just, this was Halloween weekend. Actually, this was Halloween night. Talk about a perfect treat. This was, one of the most amazing sunsets I've seen at Bombay Beach. And there's been a lot of amazing sunsets out there, both Bombay Beach and the North Shore, for that matter. But what a treat on Halloween night. And then later on, we had the full moon. The full moon was hidden by these same clouds for a while, but it did eventually work its way out. So I'll let this go ahead to the next slide, which is a similar but different. But I can't get over at the Salton Sea, and especially at Bombay Beach, how often the water, I mean, I've been out there when the water's been choppy, but more often than not, it's calm. And as you can see, very reflective like this. And one of my favorite works of art out there is this swing that was put in by these artists. One of them goes by Sippy. That's who everybody, everybody in Bombay Beach refers to him as just Sippy. His real name is Chris. And no surprise, I asked him one time, yeah, he grew up in Mississippi. I'm not sure when he moved to California.
And another artist, Damon James Duke, helped out with this. And from what they told me, the name of this piece was "The Water's Okay, Come On In," or something to that effect. And the whole point of this was to encourage people to go into the water. And that it certainly has. It's encouraged me and various other visitors to go out in the water and get up on the swing. And I go through a few more photos. Like I said, Bill Attell is one of my favorite artists. This was a drone photo I shot about a month ago of the swing. And then let's go on to this is one of my favorite ones. Let me get the text off. This was obviously the Milky Way. And again, the water was so calm that I was able to get the reflection of some of the brighter stars on the water. If you look down here, well, without that text on, you can see the Milky Way reflecting. It doesn't quite reflect in the water the same. And not all the stars do. You're only seeing the brighter stars here. And then, of course, I had to go one level above this, and I got myself on the swing. this took a bit, and this was taken that same night. This one was actually done earlier in the night. I'm kind of showing them in a random order here. You can see some ripples to the left side. You can see, like, the concentric rings there. A lot of people, when I posted this on Facebook, asked me, they said, well, you know, how long did you have to wait for the water to come out? I had to wait about 4 or 5 minutes. You know, I went out there really carefully, got up on the swing, and then I had to stay as still as I could. I have a wireless remote for my camera. And then, like I said, once the water calmed down to my satisfaction, I was able to take the picture you see here. So probably one of my personal favorites of my mini self-portraits that you see me post. And then let's go on to the next one. This was done the night before Halloween, when it was a different kind of sunset. It was a more serene sunset. It wasn't like the fire in the sky, but you look at these clouds and it almost looks like the swing set is floating in the clouds in a way. Or it's almost like you could flip this picture over and it would still look almost as good upside down. But I really like the surreal feeling that it gave here. Again, with that swing set and the clouds reflecting and kind of a muted sunset. Go on to the next one here. I got a few more photos and then some videos. This I also did Halloween weekend. I did this the Sunday night after Halloween. And I like to do star trails, but this time I was able to get star trails and I decided to leave the clouds in. And you can see the clouds were drifting as well, but I really like the way this one turned out. And then just, you know, the crusty surface of the Salton Sea. And this was done during a nearly full moon too, so it's only the brighter stars. Because the moon was so bright, you don't really see the stars reflecting in the water this time. But still, I like the effect that they created in the sky there. Go on to next one. This I also did Halloween weekend. I really like the way the colors and textures turn out here. This was a drone panorama, something that, like, until I got my drone a couple months ago, I'd never been able to shoot from an aerial angle like this, but I really like the way it turned out, just the colors and the textures and everything. You look closer, you can see that famous swing right down in there. And of course, there were other people visiting, so this kind of gives you an idea of scale. Somebody's truck was out there, and a few people visiting down there. And then I think I have my video after this. Let me go. Or no, I'm going to do a few stills. These are, I like to call them the new mud pots, but apparently they're not really new. They were just newly exposed and as the Salton Sea's dried up. These are about a mile and a half, no, about a mile and three quarters from the ones that most people know about that are at the intersection of Shrimp and Davis Roads. So these, I flew my drone out, was able to get some really nice aerial shots and video. Got a few more stills here. I mean, this almost looks like the surface of the moon or something, except it's more colorful. You can see the greenish tint in the water from the algae. And let's see here, got one more. Another one there. If you look down below here, some people, when I posted this on Facebook and Flickr and Instagram, said, oh, that looks like agriculture. No, that's actually, as most of you know, that has to do with the dust control measures that I believe the IID has been working on. where they create these little mini, they almost look like trenches for agriculture, but they're not, and they normally flood those with water to deal with the dust migration. Now, after this, I have a video that's a couple minutes of these mud pots, and it really shows off just how active they are. Got a quick story to tell about this video, though. I actually lost my drone in the process, but was later able to recover it. I was really new to flying a drone, and I was kind of pushing the limits of it, the battery, a bit too much, because I had to fly it out at least a mile and a half. You can't go out here unless, you know, you have to be in some sort of rubber suit or something, or you'd be ended up sticking to all this mud. But anyway, so my drone battery ran out before it had enough power to make it back to where I was standing. Well, the drone does keep a flight log on the controller, and the GPS location information was so accurate that I was able to go out the next day in my inflatable boat to where the exact coordinates that it said it last received signal from the drone before it crashed in the water. And I was able to recover it. Because I was able to recover it, number one, I was able to recover the high-resolution images and the video, which you're going to see next. I used a high-quality memory card that's designed to survive being underwater for up to 3 days. And also, I was able to make an insurance claim since I was able to recover the drone. Even though the salt water fried it, you know, they sent me out a new drone. So now I'm going to show you the video of the mud pots.
This is really incredible. One of the things that makes the Salton Sea so amazing is not just the water in the sky, but it is the activity going on underneath.
Oh, yeah. There's just huge volcanoes. I never get tired of, and there's always new things to see or new things to discover.
And it brings many different...
It shows just how violent and active these things are.
And geothermal potential. This could power desalination. This could power homes.
And Kevin, can you tell us anything about how this area has changed over the years? Because I know you've been photographing this area for a while.
Yeah, well, you know, it was interesting. For the longest time, these mud pots were deep under the water, and I don't think, other than a few bubbles, you really couldn't see any obvious signs of activity. And then, I want to say like 5 or 6 years, maybe about 5 years ago, the Salton Sea was, you know, continues to dry up. Well, this area was so dry that you could drive even an ordinary sedan out to this area. And this is near what used to be Mullet Island. Actually, it's a little bit north of Mullet Island, but not far. And it's also by the Red Hill Marina. Well, anyways, I couldn't get enough of, you know, taking photos of it from the ground. And then I went back like a year later, and as Curie and Tom know, I got my truck stuck in this muck, you know, and they came out and were, and with a bunch of other people, and helped get me unstuck. But yeah, this area's changed a lot though now. Like I said, I think the IID intentionally flooded this to provide more, I don't know for sure, this is just what I've heard, to provide more habitats from the duck, for the ducks and other birds, as well as to keep people from getting too close to these. Because like I said, in order to get to these now, you'd have to trudge through at least a mile and a half of really thick, gooey, wet clay muck.
Yeah,
but they're beautiful but very dangerous. One of our board members' sons fell into one, and
well, I think I heard about that. Yeah,
evacuated quickly. So do keep in mind, if you go and visit, they're beautiful, but do not get near. The ground under your feet is not solid. It is
wonderful. No, you can't get too. Yeah, no, you don't want to get too close to these. And also, a note I want to add too, because somebody had brought it up when I posted on Facebook too, is that if anybody else goes out there with the drone, please don't fly south of here, because that's the Sunny Bono Wildlife Refuge, which, of course, is mostly a bird refuge. So that kind of goes without saying. You don't want to be flying a drone in that part of the Salton Sea and unnecessarily disturbing the birds. So let me continue with this. Yeah, it just shows how you can see why they want to keep people away from these, because you could get badly hurt, as Curie mentioned.
Kevin, your music's not coming through as clearly as it could, so we may want to turn the music down if possible.
Okay. Don't. You know what? It's probably. Let me see if I can just.
There you go.
A little better on your ears?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, so. Okay, yeah. It was probably kind of choppy on your end. I can't tell on my end, but thanks for. So I think the structure here is maybe the remains of an old duck hunting blind.
Yeah, I can remember a few years ago that area was a little bit drier, so it really has changed a lot throughout the years.
And it's
good that there's more water for the birds. You know, it's nice to see that.
Oh, yeah, and you can see tons of birds here.
One fun fact about this area is it actually holds one of the best wetlands at the Salton Sea, and a significant portion of it was created by duck hunters in the summer over a couple weeks with cement chunks, carpet samples, and a lot of beer. And tipsy duck hunters were able to make one of the best wetlands at the Salton Sea, but the state of California on $100 million couldn't figure out that level of engineering marvel. So I do encourage us all to pressure our dear government and political leaders to learn how to make wetlands and continue doing what they promised.
I think they just need to get going. The same thing with saving the Salton Sea instead of doing all these endless studies, but that's, you know. So now I'm going to get back to some of the artsy stuff. And this is at Bombay Beach. I filmed this a couple months ago. This is, I forgot the exact name of this exhibit, but it's basically supposed to symbolize some sort of fantasy, dreamlike fishing. And I'll pan up here in a moment, and you'll see the person that we're supposed to symbolize, someone with a fishing rod and reel up on the roof of this. And actually, I should step back a moment. What's happened over the years is Bombay Beach is a lot of homes, both regular homes and trailer homes, that become abandoned. Artists have found that they can buy up these properties for fairly cheap, and they've done kind of quirky things like you see here. To kind of show off their art. So instead of it just being all abandoned and looking trashed, they're turning the ruins into art like this, which is really cool. And there's actually a festival that normally goes on every year. Of course, like everything else, it was canceled this year, but called the Biennale.
Bombay Beach Biennale.
Okay. I keep trying to figure out the right way to pronounce it. Some people say it's this, so it's Biennale. And this next thing is, these are just some quick videos I did with my phone. This is the Opera House. And when they do have an event, they actually do have people singing opera out front. And I'm not sure the history of the inside of the station. They created this artwork with a gazillion flip-flops. The walls, the ceiling, it's all made up of a whole bunch of flip-flops. So it's very interesting. But yeah, I'm hoping they do the Biennale next year to resume that. You know, so many of these events, of course, in 2020 have been canceled. Another art installation here. I'm not sure of the name of this one, other than I kind of jokingly call it Do Not Climb, because the artist is kind of obscured by one of the points on the lower left of the star, but it says Do Not Climb. And I don't know whether it originally had the razor wiser. I think the razor wiser is part of the artwork, but they've done a pretty good job of discouraging people from climbing on it. But I like the idea that there was a star here, and then I got a shot of the Milky Way lined up behind it. And all my shots of the Milky Way like this are done as they're seen. I don't, like, take a stock photo of the Milky Way and paste it in Photoshop. I mean, some photographers do that, and I think that's fine if they want to do that as an artistic style, but I like to do the real thing. I like to actually, you know, wait for the time of the year on a night where the Milky Way lines up properly, and that's what I did with this and my other nighttime shots. And go on to now. Like this the more of the artwork. This is outside of what they call the Polaroid Museum. This is a little bit further in, more in town in Bombay Beach. And somebody, you know, the first few times I saw it, I didn't pay much attention. I'm like, okay, they just set up like a tea set out there. But then recently I went and I took a closer look, and they've got, you know, dead tilapia. Both like kind of whole dead tilapia and some fish bones, and they made like a. So they take things that they find around the Salton Sea. I haven't seen a whole lot of dead tilapia, though, in the last couple of years. I think they've just, most of the ones that can die have died. And this is the naval, the abandoned naval station. from what I've heard, what you see in the foreground here was some sort of experimental desalination project. That's what these four things you see here. And then this was when I was still fairly new to flying my drone, so nothing too artistic or anything. I'm just kind of flying over this, and then I'll fly out to the ruins of a pier, which you've probably seen a lot of my photos from the ground of. In fact, you know what? Let me speed that up a little bit, but yeah. And I have actually camped out here a few times, too. I mean, technically, they say this is closed to the public, but I've camped out here. I've also, it's one of my favorite spots to, besides Bombay Beach, to launch my inflatable boat from. I just think it's interesting, all these structures. When the Navy did vacate this property, they tore down just about all, but not every single one of the buildings, but they left other structures like this remaining.
And there were thousands and thousands of troops stationed here. They had ships, they had some submarines, I believe. They had many different types of planes. They accidentally bombed and blew up their tennis court. They tested atomic bomb shapes. And we went on one mission for a Discovery Channel type piece looking for radioactive material with a Geiger counter there. And it's a very interesting place.
Yeah, it is. And Randy Brown did an interesting video and thing on this too, as I'm sure you saw a while back when he did the Salton Sea walk and was able to look up a lot of interesting info on this. So yeah, let me move around to next here. Just flying back over that. Like I said, this is when I was fairly new. Okay, now here, now we get for some quirky art and some really quirky so-called makeshift museums here. I do say the S word a few times because there's actually a museum called Museum Number 2. So this is, you'll see that if, shortly after I start with the intro here, the Bombay Beach Estates. This again is part of, was originally created as one of the Biennale festivals, and they decided to keep some of this stuff like the swing and these other art installations up indefinitely. So for this, I think I can turn the sound up because it shouldn't cut out like the music did.
Appropriate.
Biennale. I've never seen pictures of this. They actually had this in the water, suspended above the water during the Biennale. It's really cool and bizarre what they did, though. They took things that have to do with toilets and they made art out of it.
Is that what we think it is, Kevin?
I think that's what it is. What that wallpaper is supposed to symbolize? Because, I mean, they call it Museum Number 2. Unless it's, I don't know. And, of course, they got the toilet brushes. And then you'll see in the actual bathroom, they have plungers stuck to the walls and ceiling. Yeah, one time those fans worked. So some of the artists are still, obviously, somebody's paying for the electricity to these buildings. Yeah, I couldn't get the fans to work, but I'm sure with the slight breeze, these brushes would be moving around. Some say, I've never been to it, but some say, like Bombay Beach, these art installations, this is like a miniature version of Burning Man. It's just, it's really cool that somebody took all this abandoned, dilapidated stuff and turned it into abstract art like this. I like quirky, bizarre stuff like this. That wearing push, don't pull.
It's a wild place.
Yep.
But then one of the fantastic things about what they've been doing in Bombay Beach and the Biennale,
I know, I had to think
it's brought many, many thousands of people out to experience the art, but see the Salton Sea, and they learn about it when they're here, and they carry on reasons and understanding of a place that deserves attention and love and support.
Oh yeah, it's definitely brought, you know, I mean, especially you go out here on the weekend stuff, it's brought tons of people out that probably prior to a lot of these art installations going out here, most people, other than a handful of photographers like myself, wouldn't have known of this place. But then people see stuff like this posted on Facebook or Instagram, and then they want to go out there and explore it and photograph it themselves. So as Kiri, as you said, it's drawn a lot. And things like the swing, where that was intentionally placed in the water to encourage people to go in the water and realize, you know, the Salton Sea isn't just some toxic waste dump or something, that, you know, it's worth doing something about to save it. So when I went here a week ago, these lights were no longer in motion like that. They were just on solid. So I think they'll need to fix that. But this was done a few months ago when it was in better shape.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So how am I doing on time? I'm like,
got about 10 more minutes.
Okay, good. So I'm more than 3/4 of the way done. So
yeah, 5 to 10 more minutes.
Okay. Actually, you know what? I can speed this up a bit because you don't need to see all that. It's like an old outhouse. I'm speeding some of this up a bit. Just let's see here. And then it kind of just lit up that decaying trailer. It's really cool, just some of the stuff they've done here. And this is kind of like the area where they would normally have the parties and the goings-ons when they have the Biennale festival. Let me speed up a little. Speed up some of this. I always thought that what they did to this building is kind of interesting, because when you they hung a bunch of pages of books inside here. Let me speed that up a little bit here. So yeah, that's about it. For any of you that want to see more, Kevin Key Photography.com, YouTube, slow working too, and Instagram, slow working. I got my phone number there. Anybody wants to see more of my work? I took this selfie just last weekend, obviously in front of the Bombay Beach sign. Anybody have any questions or anything?
Yeah, okay. Tell me more about your nighttime photography, like with all the star trails and the galaxies. How exactly do you do that? You must have it on a timer or something.
Yeah, for the star trails, it's essentially a long exposure, except the old way of doing it back in the film days was you would do like an hour or 2 hour long exposure, and you kept the shutter open for that length of time. In the digital age, though, what you do is you do a series of shorter exposures, and then you use software to stack them, and that's what I do. So I'll do anywhere from like 12 to 30 second individual exposures over a period of anywhere from an hour to sometimes I did them as long as 3 hours. And then you stack them together with software, so it creates that effect of a long exposure.
So how long does it take you on average to create one of those long exposure, or, you know, the Star Trail photo? How long does it take you in Photoshop to stitch it all together or stack it?
Well, okay, so first it would be on average, I like to do about 2 hours of shooting. And then in Photoshop, actually I use, you can use Photoshop, but I found some better software called Sequinor. And it uses an algorithm and senses where the stars are. I think it takes the brightest part of each frame and stacks it together. But that part's usually done within a few minutes where it has the star trails. But then usually it's looking kind of bland, so I turn the saturation up a bit and mess with the contrast and the clarity. And but especially with the saturation, to really make the colors in the star trails pop. So they don't just look like white streaks or white circles. Beginning a couple of years ago, I've gone from, instead of just creating plain old white star trails, I like to make them more colorful. And I've found what helps with that is actually using a lower ISO number and a smaller aperture, which kind of goes normally with astrophotography. You want to open the aperture wide up so it's nice and bright and cranked up. But if you want to bring up the color in star trails, there's some tricks you can do that.
So you're not adding individual colors specifically. You're honing the colors that exist in these stars?
That I am. I try to find, like I said, with most of my photography, I try to find the right settings and all that to naturally make it look that way. Whereas, yeah, some photographers, they will go in and they'll paint the colors in. But to me, I consider that cheating. Or at least if you're going to do that, you know, which I think some people will do that and they're upfront about that and they'll say, you know, this is considered artistic photography. But I like to try and take what nature provided and just do a little bit of enhancing on it rather than create something that wasn't really there. And then the way over the years, it's just been a matter of figuring out the optimal settings, because you don't want to use too high of an ISO setting or the photo will look really grainy. But if you use too low and you do too long of an exposure, then the Milky Way due to star movement will get a little blurry. I mean, the star movement, you want that in star trails, but with the Milky Way, you want the photo to be nice and sharp. It's just, yeah, learning various techniques over the years.
I have one question coming in. Do you have a favorite place to look at the stars when they come and visit the Salton Sea?
Yeah, Bombay Beach is a good one. It's one of the darker communities. Although also the old naval station, if you have four-wheel drive and you're experienced driving off-road, that's a good place to go as well. And the Salton Sea, the areas around the Salton Sea aren't quite as dark as where I also go, which is in the mountains of San Diego, like Mount Laguna or Anza Borrego, but it's still dark enough that, as you can see, you can get some decent shots of the Milky Way and the stars. The Milky Way season is pretty much over now this time of year. What happens is the Milky Way, the brighter core part of Milky Way rises and sets at a little bit earlier each day as the year goes on. To what happens this time of year is the Milky Way rises well before sunset, and now the core of it sets before sunset. You can still see the Milky Way per se, just not that really bright, brilliant galaxy core part of it. You'll be able to see it again really early in the morning, beginning in mid-February. But if you want to see it at a convenient time, generally like around July or so, you can just be in an area where the skies are nice and dark, and you'll be able to see it on a nice, clear, low humidity night, you know, at say around 9 p.m., 10 p.m. So, yeah.
Oh, there we go. Fantastic, Kevin.
Muted.
Thanks. Tonight. We've appreciated your support through the years, joining us at many different events, in person and online, and all of the work that you do for the Salton Sea. You've been a big leader in showing the beauty of this place and reasons that it needs to be saved. So
thanks.
We hope you could stay for the rest of the video. We do have something for you at the end. And I'm going to jump into the work of a couple other artists in the Salton Sea. And another way using art to tell a story for awareness. So let us jump over to an artist named Jenny Bate. I'm going to show a little bit of her work. So this is an artist that lives in Salton City. She uses mixed medium to create landscapes, and many of them are based on the Salton Sea. She has a view that looks out over the sea and is inspired by these beautiful, colorful landscapes that look a lot like the picture that Kevin used as his background tonight. They're stunning.
These are cool.
Very unique. And she's a member of the Salton Sea Artists Association. There is a Salton Sea Artists Association. They have a group on Facebook, as well as quite a few different artist communities that are popping up. A lot of people on Instagram are sharing work, and it's neat to see these stories being told. One of the reasons that I wanted to bring Jenny Bate's work up is we worked together, the EcoMedia Compass, the Artists Association, and a lead designed by Jenny to help rehab part of a town. And Salton Sea Beach is a town similar to Bombay Beach on the West Shores, where it had some flooding damage and some parts of it looked pretty dire. They have a huge welcome sign that was dilapidated and looking really rough, and people weren't proud of it anymore. So we teamed up a few years ago and made the Welcome Salton Sea Beach sign. So this is massive. This is probably 10 by 20 feet. The EcoMedia Compass and the Artists Association spent weeks working on this sign. It's double-sided. You'll see it off to the side of the 86 when you come by. And keep a lookout for it. It's fun. Go take a picture, post it. And out of all of the different types of restoration projects we've done, this was one that really hit the hearts of people. They said they were proud to live in this town again and really, really happy. And that's because art came back. So we're really honored that we're able to do this type of project, and we look forward to future artistic projects. We have a few other exciting things. So we have one other artist that I'm going to showcase, and then we have a piece of awareness through art. Looks like we have a couple more people coming in. Great. So one artist that we've worked with at the Salton Sea, his name is Gamini Ratnavir. And this gentleman has done conservation projects around the world, has stories with every kind of animal that I could think of. He's birthed wild deer and almost killed by moray eels and swam with river otters. And he came and met us at the Salton Sea a bit back and did some work for our campaign. And this was when we brought him. He's an incredible expert on wildlife.
I think this is a paradise that should be
about his work
considered. And it's we lose this, we lose a part of our soul. So it's very important to see that this is preserved and recreated for the betterment of our future. I mean, there's absolutely no way to replace something like this. Let it go now. Getting back into this is not going to be, it's almost impossible. So, got to take action right now. And one of the reasons I'm here is to try and recreate this environment and the beauty of this place in a form of art that will remain for the rest of my lifetime. And hopefully it will trigger some interest in the people around us to really understand the beauty of nature that's freely given to us, and we need to take care of it.
So that's Gamini Ratnavira. We're going to jump over to his website, look at a couple pieces, and then we have a couple pieces that he has donated for our awareness campaign, and we'll jump into those. I'm excited about that, actually. Two species that we're going to focus on tonight are the common tern and the coyote. Jasmine, do you have any favorite things about the tern or the coyote that you'd like to mention tonight?
I do. What I really like about the terns is watching them when I'm at the Salton Sea, because they eat fish. And when I'm standing on the shore, I can actually watch the terns flying and diving into the Salton Sea, and you can see them picking up small fish. So sometimes people think that there's no more fish in the Salton Sea, but the truth is there still are fish that are adapting to the rising salinity and the other challenging conditions at the Salton Sea. So that's really encouraging that there's evidence of life all around us, and we just need to take the time to slow down, really look, and then we'll find it.
Thank you, Jasmine. That's beautiful and so true. And this is the common tern, and this is a species that is at the Salton Sea. There are 424 different bird species that have been found at the Salton Sea, which is one of the more biodiverse places in the world. And we need to maintain that. So this piece is actually available tonight. We said we'd have an art show. Here we are. This piece has been donated by Gamini Ratnavira. I'm going to jump over to his website, show you a little bit more about this artist, and then we have another piece and species that we'd like to showcase. And thank you so much, Jasmine. She's an expert on the avian species at the Salton Sea, and such a pleasure to work with. She's our co-host tonight, also a fantastic photographer. This is the work of Gamini Ratnavira. He's focused on many, many different species. Currently, he's painting every single hummingbird in the world, of which there are over 300. So he's going into doing one of each of those. He's done a lot of the species at the Salton Sea. He's done an art fundraiser for us. He's originally from Sri Lanka and has done quite a bit to bring awareness to the art of this place and the wildlife of this place, and operates and founded a conservation center there. And he's been working around the world for decades to support nonprofits and the work of conservation. So this piece of art that you saw just a moment ago, the common tern, is available tonight. We're gonna do just a soft auction, and then we'll jump into the rest of our piece. So this is available starting at $25. This is valued at about $400. It's a signed original print. We would send this to you. So let us know if we can start a bid at $25.
How large is the print?
So I believe this is 24 by 36, but it's about this big, if you could see the football.
Yeah, that's a good size. Bottoms.
It's a beautiful, beautiful print that would look fantastic on a wildlife lover's wall. So this is available tonight. Text in if you would like to put in a bid for this piece. Also, I'm going to jump into one other piece that we are actually going to gift to our art presenter tonight, because this species holds down the ecosystem in many different ways. It's a very wily creature. It's a very smart creature. And it reminds me, in a very dear way, a little bit of our friend Kevin, who is such an adventurer. Can you tell us a little bit about the coyote, Jasmine?
I think the coyote is really an integral species at the Salton Sea, but also, you know, pretty much throughout the world. Just because they're common doesn't mean we should undervalue them. They are highly adaptable. They are an important part of the food chain. And I often see coyotes when I'm walking on the shore. And it's always a treat to see them. Usually I see jackrabbits too when I see the coyotes, you know, so you really get to see nature in action. And it reminds me that when I explore the Salton seashore, it's not dead, it's not lifeless. I see coyotes, I see jackrabbits, I see lizards, I see butterflies, I see spiders. There's life all around.
It definitely is, and thanks.
Sure, Kevin, thank you so much
cool.
for joining us through the years. It's a picture that I really love of Gamini's, and he donated it for this event. So we're going to send you that for being with us tonight.
Really
so
appreciate it. Much.
Once again, if anyone would like to jump on that turn, fantastic. We are going to, in just a moment, close with our last art exhibition of the evening in a way that is done by the EcoMedia Compass and has brought a lot of awareness to the Salton Sea and the Save Our Sea campaign's reasons for saving the Salton Sea. Do we have any questions tonight about the art of the Salton Sea? There are thousands of different artists. We've worked with many, many different artists. We can talk about different aspects of art. Any questions for Kevin and his beautiful, beautiful nightscapes, sunsets, adventuring, exploring style of photography? Any questions about wildlife photography? We'll give it just another moment and then we'll go into closure.
I have a question for you, Kevin. I've wondered, how has your style of photography changed and evolved over the years as you've been shooting the Salton Sea? Because I noticed there has been a shift. What do you want to say about that?
And I think I know what you're getting at. And that was originally years ago when I would explore the Salton Sea, it was about kind of that Mad Max feel, the decay, the abandoned stuff. And then over the years, I still occasionally photograph some of that, but now it's more about the natural beauty of the Salton Sea. Whether it's the Milky Way and then the reflections of the stars glistening on the water, of course, the sunsets, the mudpots. So yeah, it's definitely shifted more from, you know, that gritty decay, you know, falling down buildings and old trailers and graffiti and all that, more to the natural beauty. And I think that's what you're referring to, right?
Yeah, I wanted to say it's been a real pleasure over the years to see your work, you know, grow and change. As artists, we do that. And I, you know, think it's a really positive thing for the Salton Sea. And I want to express my appreciation for everything that you do for the Salton Sea. You do a lot.
Thanks, I appreciate it. And I think like what you mentioned a few minutes ago, about you got to stop and look out. And I think that's something too, is I've, you know, before I would just go out there and like, oh, there's an abandoned building, I'm going to take a few pictures of it. Now, like, especially when I camp out there and stuff, I have more time to stop and just, you know, do nothing but enjoy the sights and sounds of nature. And I notice more things, like you were saying, when some people at first glance, they think the Salton Sea or even just the desert in general, it's lifeless. But the more times you visit, the more time you spend out there, you see things that most people wouldn't take the time to see. And like you were talking about, the bugs and the, you know, the coyotes, the bird, you know, all those things that, you know, most people wouldn't see at first, spiders and all that. But when you spend a lot of time and you let your mind and body focus on your surroundings without distractions, yeah, you start to know. And that happened with me over the years. I'm like, well, not only is there a bunch of abandoned stuff here, but there's a lot of beauty in the Salton Sea. And there's still life.
Definitely.
It's amazing like how like the tilapia and other fish have adapted.
Yeah.
To harsh conditions.
Yeah, agreed.
There are still many tilapia. There are still some corvina that we think. There are still desert pupfish. There was one other species of fish, I believe, that have been seen recently. What was that, Jasmine?
They're sailfin mollies still live in the Salton Sea, and possibly mosquito fish. So these sailfin mollies and mosquito fish are like 2-3 inches. They live in the drains that flow into the Salton Sea. So on occasion, they swim along the shoreline. But we found them very, very far away from any of the drains that flow into the Salton Sea. So it shows that they are capable of adapting to the rising salinity. Not sure for how much longer, but it's still encouraging that it's a living ecosystem.
Yeah. Definitely. There's that phrase, you know, nature finds a way, and that's you know, the Salton Sea is a perfect example of that, you know, the you know, the tilapia especially are adapting. I mean, they can only do so for so long.
Yeah.
It gets
I read another recent report just last week. A fisherman at the Salton Sea had sent in a question to, I think it was California Department of Fish and Wildlife, saying, I'm sure I saw corvina, but I thought they were not living anymore. So it's interesting. It would have been great if you'd gotten a picture, but that's the second eyewitness account in the last 2 years that I've heard of people spotting corvina. So we shouldn't underestimate nature. You know, they can adapt.
Oh, yeah.
At
the
time, there were seals that were introduced at a dance hall near where Kevin was showing the mud pots. They lasted for a little while. There were flamingos seen at the Salton Sea, and just incredible biodiversity. Also many, many critical species that need our support. So I'm going to turn over a little bit to more of the reason why we do what we do, is solving some of these environmental challenges. So California has lost close to 95% of its wetlands in the last 100 years, and we've paved over them, we've built over them, we've drained them, we've put parking lots on them, and the Salton Sea has 100 miles of shoreline. And the biggest factor to the amount of life there, first off, is not enough water, then too much salt, and then some toxicity issues. Those are our main challenges at the Salton Sea. The fish and some of the birds are facing issues with the salt. But our biggest thing is we need more water to make sure that we are sustained over the generations and these species can make it. So we have a couple projects that we've been very, very supportive of over the years. I'm gonna jump over to our website, and then we'll close out with a one last video piece. So this is the ecomediacompass.org. This is growing. We keep adding resources and solutions. We have petitions, videos, action resources where you can reach out to political leaders, write letters. We need this.
I think I saw myself in that top photo. I remember when that was taken a few years ago.
Quite possible. Yeah, this is that one
off
of our...
to the left there, near the guy with the orange shirt. I think that's me wearing black. To the left of him. Well, the left as you're looking at the photo.
Yeah, great. Got a sailboat out there. Two projects that we're really big on. We're very supportive of adding water from the ocean. If you have water, there is no dust. There aren't people getting sick from silts blowing off the exposed playa that could have agricultural chemicals in them, that could have harsh salts, PM 2.5, PM 10, some tough stuff for us to breathe. If it's wet, that does not happen. So we're also very supportive of this because you can desalinate however much water you would like to. So this can create water resources for future generations in perpetuity and solve water issues in the Southwest. And you can also separate salinities and bring in higher quality ocean water to support life, to support marine life. So we're very supportive of this, and we're working on currently supporting the work of some nonprofits that have been working in the Coachella Valley to get resolutions passed to support seawater import by different city councils. So we're moving into the Imperial Valley in this same mission to get cities to understand that water is life, and this brings so much possibility. Yes, health and environment, but also incredible economic potential to have a sustainable shoreline and a place that people really want to come. So we're working as one of the active points of our campaign. We also have the West Shores Restoration Project at Desert Shores, the Desert Shores Restoration Project, as you see here. We have land in Desert Shores where we are building a berm to pump water back into this dried community. It's drier than this now. To bring the water level up for the residents, for health, and eventually treat the water for high quality habitat there. So we have some upcoming events touching on both of these things. We'll be out there doing some filming next week. That'll be neat. But December 13th, we're going What's Going On in Desert Shores. This is a highly anticipated event. We have some major announcements to make, some work with the county that's coming out, some work with Engineers Without Borders potentially that's coming out, and some things that we would like to announce to you then. But we have no announcements to make until this main event. So we're really excited to have you there then. Also on January 31st, we have teams that have presented overall restoration solutions for the Salton Sea about adding water. The solution that solves the most challenges is adding water. So January 31st, we're happy to have you there. We already have a few volunteers involved that are going to be doing outreach for this to different political leaders. We have many of the different scientific groups in conversation. If you'd like to support the work of either of these events and these campaigns, please reach out. Let us know. You can reach us at ecomediacompass.org, on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Email is info@ecomediacompass.org. I also want to touch on this picture. It was by one of our great volunteers, our campaign director for many years, was Giovanni Arechavaleta, and he took this photo. This was seen on Splash, actually. So this work has gone now.
It looks like it may have been taken off of Salton Sea Beach, because that's
so
the only place I know of where there's still telephone poles in the water, or at least there were.
And it's neat to see the places where there's big nests up top.
Yeah.
One other section that we want to show you on our website is we've been a part of dozens and dozens of video productions, three full-length movies, pieces from many different college crews, the news in Australia, from South Korea, England, France, Germany, Vice News, Al Jazeera. We've done work with the Washington Post, LA Times. This stuff can be shared. Please tune in. This Breaking Point piece won Emmys. We won 4 Emmys partnering with Palomar College there. So we encourage you to share these high quality pieces about salt sea restoration. We're going to close tonight with one video that has brought quite a bit of awareness to the Salton Sea, and it was the world's largest SOS. This partnered with Randy Brown. Drum work by our very own Eric Hanscom, one of our esteemed board members, as well as Randy Brown.
Save our seat.
So this is at the abandoned military base that Kevin was touring.
This had to take a bit of a coordinated effort with, you know, walkie-talkie and stuff. It would be just from the ground, it would be hard to tell whether you were getting the jeeps lined up properly. Pretty cool.
Leader of one of the Jeep crews.
Cool.
It's the rhythm. So We thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Once again, art can carry a story, can carry a cause so far, but not all the way. We need to get involved for the reasons that this art is coming out here at the Salton Sea, ultimately for restoration. We're a group of volunteers, and we can't do this without your help. So if you're ever able to donate, we truly, truly appreciate it. This keeps us working on the Salton Sea restoration efforts, and we want to keep doing this. This isn't just a project. This isn't just something that needs to be fixed. This is a stewardship of a place that is going to live on far longer than us in whatever condition it's in. So let's give it our best. It's good for everyone. So thank you so much. Thank you, Jasmine, our lovely co-host. So happy to have you here tonight. Thank you, Kevin Key, our keynote. Message me after. You could find Kevin Key, Google him. He has a great website, social media there. Jasmine Phillips, she has some fantastic wildlife art. I encourage you to reach out. Gamini Ratnavira, wildlife artist. Little Galaxies was the band that performed the music for SOS here. They also partnered with us on a film that we did. Jenny Bates, fantastic local Salton Sea artist. And we're really, really grateful to continue working with artists. If you have people in mind that would be need to work with, please reach out. We'd love to learn more. So without further ado, it has been such a pleasure. And Kevin and Jasmine on three, you want to do a Save Our Sea?
Yeah.
All right, one, two, three. Save our sea! All right, thank you so much. We will see you for our next event very soon in December. Check us out, ecomediacompass.org. What's going on in Desert Shores? All right, good night. Thank you all.